So welcome everybody, and thanks to all of you for attending this new event in the Cool Talks by ClearPix, our webinar series focused on data analytics and management. My name is Gianluca Nacci. I am the general manager of the Middle Eastern branch of ClearPix. I will spend the next 5 minutes introducing the webinar agenda, our company and capabilities, to then introduce the topics of the webinar. With me is my colleague Diman Day, head of the Advanced Analytics Practice and Delivery Lead in ClearPix, who will showcase our business case in this webinar and participate to the Q&A panel at the end of the presentation. On this regard, because of the broad audience to this webinar, we have disabled the speech function on attendees. So we recommend you to ask your questions using the Q&A function you see in the Zoom control panel. We are reserving also a bit of time for answering your questions towards the end of the webinar, and whatever unanswered question remains, stay assured it will be dealt with after the webinar via mail. Please also do not hesitate to share this session once it's going to be recorded with your network. The purpose of this webinar is to introduce a powerful use case for marketing optimization by using social listening to help you tailoring campaigns and actions. During this webinar, we will briefly introduce our company and services, the social listening use case, and the Data Equo and Click Oracle architecture we have used to implement it. Then we will showcase our demo and describe our key findings and conclusions, and hopefully have time for a Q&A panel with our technical team at the end. Next, please. So who are we? ClearPix is an end-to-end business analytics consultancy firm operating worldwide for the last 20 years with a broad customer and projects portfolio and success stories across more than 20 industries. Our headquarters is in Barcelona, in Spain, and we have offices in Abu Dhabi and Dubai. Our services, serviced by more than 100 employees, span from business intelligence to big data and advanced analytics, complemented by web and mobile capabilities for tailored solutions. We invest in the leading and most state-of-the-art technologies and methodologies to help our customers make the most of their data, whatever the data is and wherever the data is. Next, please. To help our customers achieving their business goals, we provide a full end-to-end portfolio of services, from the inception of the data journey by estimating company readiness and helping them formulating a strategy, to determining what are the program success factors, and then delving into the business requirements, collecting and consolidating them, to then implementing and supporting the project, whether it's business intelligence, big data, machine learning, and artificial intelligence, all of it under a solid data governance and management layer. The outcome of our work spans from executive and management-oriented analytics to real-time operational and tactical data discovery reporting and enablement to web and mobile applications tailored and made just for you. For this webinar, however, we will concentrate on both data discovery and advanced analytics capabilities. On this purpose, I will now pass the baton to Diman Day, our advanced analytics delivery lead, who will introduce the business case and showcase our solution.
As we all know, social listening can actually help us into different areas of, you know, marketing campaigns, or understanding the, you know, geographical footprint of our customer bases. At the same time, what marketing admins or marketing managers look for in terms of features and benefits are to have some form of competitive analysis or competitive edge with regards to the other brands in the same industries that they compete with. So we are going to look at a use case today to how to take the or how to take benefit from the social channel conversations that are happening across your user bases, and just to understand, you know, what kind of, you know, social pulse is your customers talking about or conversing around towards your brand as well as your competitors as well. At the same time, you're also going to understand and look at some of the analysis that can cover, you know, the top influencers in your consumer base. At the same time, your competitors' consumer base as well. Finally, we are going to look at a very small real-time monitoring dashboarding exercise and how that is going to help you or the marketing team keep an eye on the entire aspect of things, either historical or in real-time as well. So just to summarize, the business case is about understanding social listening around your brand equity, the brand value, or the conversations around the products and services that you have. And at the same time, you would like to monitor and calculate certain KPIs that can help you gauge the performance of your social branding or presence for your customers. While doing so, the deliverables that are in hand, we are talking about a dashboard, which will display all the necessary information for you, summarized and consolidated in a consumable fashion for your marketing admins without any in-depth understanding of how the backend machine learning and AI tech works. So we are going to talk around geographical spread, social impact, sentiment analysis, the influence in users, or the different topics that are being conversed in the social media channels. We are also going to look at how these topics grow or dissipate across historical timelines, at the same time having an understanding of the sentiment for each of the topics as well, in tandem with the influential users, so that whenever you are trying to make decisions around your next campaign content or next collaboration effort with different influencers, you can pinpoint the collaborators that you would like to go for. We are also going to have a live dashboard. And as part of the deliverable, if you choose to go for the solution from ClearPeaks, we would also set up the environment, do the required installation, the configuration of the required platforms and so on. And user training and technical documentations across the solution will also be provided. Now, coming to the third aspect, what's the value tracking? Obviously, a major value gain out of this would be the optimization and the savings that you would get from your marketing budget. You don't need to do a spray and pray tactics for your marketing campaigns. You would be having all the necessary insights to actually understand and target or curate content or deliver content in the right way, in the most trending way that is possible. With the social listening tool that you have, you can understand what are the different ideas or notions that your customer base is talking about, so that you can actually form your next campaign content according to those lines. Next would be, it's a derived value from all the exercise that we do. It's kind of a growth of the brand equity that you have. You also have competitive edge against your competitors in terms of the engagement factors or the KPIs that you are measuring, in terms of likes, in terms of sharing, amplification, virality, and so on. So all those different KPIs in tandem to or in comparison to your competitor, we are going to lay out in front of your marketing team. And your marketing team can basically take the decisions based on those important metrics. Finally, the optimization of the productivity output of your marketing team. The marketing team, day in, day out, does not have to go through all the different tweets or all the different social media conversations that are happening manually. The solution, what we have using machine learning and AI in the backend, they are going to process all those text tweet informations, and they are going to consolidate, they are going to understand what these tweets are talking about and give them the necessary indicators and consolidate that for your marketing team in a consumable structure for your marketing team. So that would immensely impact on the time and effort that your marketing team puts across while deciding or while analyzing the different conversations that are happening. They do not have to do that manually anymore. They can save time and just go through the dashboard and understand the consolidated information that the machine learning and AI models would do for them. So that in a whole is all about the business case, what we are trying to solve, what you're going to get, and the value tracking against this particular solution. So next, we're going to quickly go into the demo, just to give you a feel of what we're trying to do here. So first thing first, before getting into the high-level dashboard of what the marketing team is actually going to look at, we have done this entire exercise using the DataIQ platform for the entire backend analysis and the services or the processing of the text that we gather. And based on all the outputs that we gather from this particular platform, we basically push it to a database, and from where our visualization platform is going to take it up, and then we are going to come to the dashboard area and look at how the consolidation has happened and how that consumable structure has been formed for the marketing team. So first and foremost, what we have is we have this data load and preparation. So we, in our case, just to give a quick understanding of the context, so we are taking into consideration only the Twitter channel for now, okay? And we have a Python script in a VM in the cloud, which basically reads all the tweets for two different brands and loads that information into a MySQL database. For our scenario, what we have taken is we are assuming that we are working for a brand named Adidas, and Adidas would like to understand how their social presence or social branding looks like in terms of customer pulse. And at the same time, they also would like to understand what their competitor Nike is doing in the same front as well. So keeping that context in mind, okay, what we're doing is we are fetching all the tweets that mention keywords associated with Adidas and Nike and store that information in the MySQL database that we have. And that is where DataIQ comes in. We basically fetch all the data from the MySQL database, as you can see in this particular flow zone, data load and preparation. And we do a quick preparation of all the tweets that are coming in. Okay, we do removing particular columns that are not required, whether it's a retweet or not, or whether we need to extract the URLs that come in from the tweets, and all the other necessary text-based processing that we need. It is required to do for your NLP-based models to work. So we do cleansing operations like removing stop words, removing special characters, emojis, and so on. Okay, and after that, we have the entire clean data set that we would require for our analysis. And the next step that we do is we do a process split. So as I said, we are actually getting all the information for both the categories of data, both the brands, that is Adidas and Nike. What we do is we separate those tweets that are mentioning Nike and associated terms and Adidas and associated terms for the separate process. And for that particular pipeline, what we do is we basically run additional cleansing processes and then have our models in play. So for the models, what we have is we have custom notebooks, which helps us derive the topics that are being generated out of the text. In the topics, we have standard LDA model that we have used, and the standard NLP processing cleansing for uniqueness, removing null values, removing stop words or punctuations and all those things. And we also do the standard pre-processing like count vectorizations or the TF-IDF conversions. And then we do the topic modeling exercise. After we do the topic modeling exercise, we basically decide upon the optimum number of topics that we would like to look at. After your analysis, we decide that we are going to go for a 6-topic cluster for our data set. And while doing so, we do all the analysis. The model does its executions. And finally, we basically have this visualization of the topics that we have created or the clusters that we have created. And this is where a manual intervention comes into play. So the clusters that gets generated from here are system generated or the model generated to interpret what this particular cluster is talking about a data analyst has to go in and understand, okay, what this particular cluster is actually talking about. And for that, what they have to do is they come back. So after this particular notebook is run, it basically writes the topics into this added as topics managed dataset in DataIQ. And in DataIQ, we come back here. So as you can see, for the added as topic, we have these added as topics in play. And as you can see, the name of the topic is topic 0, topic 1, and topic 2, and so on. So 6 topics that are named in the generic way. So what the data analyst every day would do is they would come to this editable data set and basically rename the topic to the actual functional significance that it means. Okay. And then basically write it back to the final topics data set that they have. And we do the similar process for the Nike streaming data as well. Okay. So end of the day, what we have is for all the tweets in a weekly fashion or a daily fashion, depending on the workflow frequency that you have, you basically have these two data sets. One is the Nike topics final and Adidas topics final, which basically has the tweet and the associated topic that it has in functional significance. Okay. The other thing is you can also, you know, display the insights that you get from the notebooks in certain dashboards in DataIQ as well. So this is just to showcase the features that DataIQ provides. But for operational structures, what we're going to do is we are going to incorporate these data sets, final data sets, into our Power BI dashboards. And this is how we are going to look at all the KPIs and everything that we have created here. So very quickly, so what we have so far is we have two brands that we are competing against each other. Okay, so our client is Adidas, and that is what you see here. On the left hand side, you have all the slices that are possible, the demographics, that is the country, or if you want to select by user, or if you want to select for a timeline. As you can see, the data set that we have in the historical segment is from 21st of April till 30th of April of this year. And you can also select by sentiment, whether they are positive, negative, or neutral. At the same time, you can also slice and dice based on, you know, your different topic names. Okay. So if you select a particular topic, your entire dashboard changes and you can see relevant information about that single topic given to you. So for Adidas, for discounts, you can see the associated changes that are happening. Let's go back. And as you can see on the right-hand side, we have these different visuals. So as you can see, this is the, you know, landing page that you have for, you know, your Power BI dashboard. And what we're doing here is the earlier data sets that you have seen, the final data sets that we have captured in DataIQ, we basically expose those data sets into our Power BI dashboard and basically create the landing discovery analysis for our marketing team. On the left-hand side, you have these Adidas and Nike buttons, which basically switches between the two brands that we are having. Okay. And then you also have the other slices like country or users or the timeline, sentiment, and different topics. You can also select a particular topic and see associated changes that are happening for that topic as well. Now, what this data, this dashboard is particularly telling us is an overall summary, what we call as at a glance. So on the right-hand side, you see all these four different visuals that we have. The first one is the brand selected, as you can see, is Adidas, and key information or key KPIs around that particular brand. So number of tweets, number of overall followers, the average sentiment value for that entire brand, all the tweets that has been made, and what's the most important or most discussed topic for that particular brand over the selected timeline that we have. So as you can see, we have the most discussed topic to be as Poshmark. Poshmark is an online marketplace in the US, which deals in, you know, used items of luxury brands. So as you can see, for Adidas, it seems that there are a lot of products that are being sold of Adidas and Nike in those online marketplace as well for used items. On the bottom, you know, heat map, what you can see is the distribution of different topics in number of tweets. And as you can see, Poshmark is the highest one. Then you have online shopping, discounts, others new releases and opinion in their order. And on the top right, you have the sentiment evolution that is happening against the competition. So good thing here that you can see is Adidas is actually going on a positive trend and on a, and it's on an increased trend day on day. Interestingly, for its competitor, it's not that great. And over the last day, on the last day, it has actually fallen to the negative zone altogether. So we'd like to understand these things a little in detail, but this is just a summary understanding. So this basically gives an entry point of all the analysis that your marketing team would like to do for going forward. Let's have a look at the associated KPIs for the Nike brand as well. That is our competitor. Quick KPIs that we'd like to keep in mind. Average sentiment value for Adidas is 0.42, which is on the positive side. Number of volume of tweets is 33K. Let's see how it's doing for Nike, for the competitor. So the moment we select for Nike, as you can see, the volume of tweets are really, really high, almost three to four times of what Adidas has. But good thing is, even though their volume is really great, the average sentiment value is not that great. It's almost on the fence between, it's slightly over the fence towards the positive side, but it's very, very negligible. Again, the most discussed topic is Poshmark again. So something to take note. The other areas, sentiment evolution is, as you have seen in the against Adidas as well, the sentiment for Nike compared to Adidas is actually going down and has a negative trend whatsoever. Next thing what we'd like to look at is a competitor in analysis, kind of a journey analysis of your social outlook. What we understand is, you know, the social KPIs that we consider while doing a social pulse analysis in a very intrinsic way is not only looking at the volume or the raw numbers, but the functional significance in the journey that it plays. So what you can see here is it's a very easy way to understand the proportion of engagements that you're having in a from a background of journey analysis as well. So all these four plots basically talks about the KPIs, whether it's number of tweets, number of views, engagement or virality against each other. So you have the light green option as your Nike KPI, sorry, the Adidas KPI, and the dark blue one for the Nike KPI. So the first one is actually talking about volume, that what's the footprint of the number of tweets that you have. So amount of engagement probability that you might have is directly correlated with the number of tweets that you're making. Your visibility index, your footprint in the social channel, that gives a direct understanding or that has a direct correlation with the number of tweets that you're making. So as you can see, in respect to that, Adidas is not doing that well, but although it has picked up for the last couple of days around 26th, 27th and 28th of April, so it has tried to create more and more tweets and it has got that sudden boost of number of tweets that they were making. So they have got a quick bump in their volume of tweets that they are making, and that has led to the number of views as well. So again, the number of tweets that you're doing is exactly proportional to the number of views. And as you can see, the trend or the proportional changes that you see against the timeline, it's almost similar to the number of tweets that you have. But yes, considering the number of tweets or the proportion of tweets that Adidas has against Nike, the visibility is a little better. So if you see for 26th, 27th, 28th, especially for 27th, in terms of proportion of number of tweets, it's 45 for Adidas. But in terms of visibility, it's actually more than 50%. So that shows that it might be something to do with the content, that even though their proportion of number of tweets are less than Nike, their visibility is more than Nike. So definitely the content has some part to play in that. So to enforce that particular hypothesis, what we can do is you can quickly look at the third visual that we have, the engagement visual. Interestingly, till 26th, you know, Nike was dominating the engagement KPIs. But as you can see on 27th, Adidas has just come out of the park and destroyed and taken over the footprint of Nike altogether. So that clearly shows the journey is actually effective in a very well-fashioned way. The number of tweets that they have made has garnered them more number of views. And at the same time, it has given them a huge boost in number of in the engagement KPIs as well. And considering to the, compared to that fact, if we go to the last segment of the visuals, the virality is equally important and equally engaging for Adidas as well. Now, again, even though the engagement has been low for Adidas over the years, their content virality is really high. As you can see, for April 21st, 22nd, 23rd, as well as for 27th and 28th, the virality factor of the content that Adidas throws out is really, really high. So for our client, definitely the strong area is the virality in the content that they create. Although what they need to increase is, or the improve is, in the engagement factors or the volume of tweets or the volume of views that they are getting. They are getting destroyed by Nike in the forms of volume of tweets that they're doing and forms of visibility that they're getting out of those tweets. So next, what we're going to do is, so this has given us another perspective to the entire aspect of KPIs that we're looking at. What we're going to look at next is the topic analysis that we have done. So for the different topics that are being discussed, you know, what is the spread? What is the evolution of those topics? And how does sentiment in each of these topics look like? We're going to look at that. So for Adidas, you know, you see all these different topics. Clearly, by number of tweets, Adidas brand is not doing that well. You can see in every topic, the number of volumes is very, very less, except for others. Okay. So that again enforces the idea that our client Adidas has to do really, really well in terms of increasing their volume of footprint. Okay. At the same time, if I select a particular topic, let's say new releases, we can see for Adidas, you have different sentiment evaluation for that topic. So it's going downwards. If I select another topic, let's say discounts, it's actually having an upward trend. At the same time, you get an understanding of what are the different terms that are being used by the users. Free shipping, retail, availability, the discounts, the price, Ultra Boost, the name of the brands, name of the products that they are using. At the same time, if you'd like to understand for your competitor as well, you just click on the Nike button. And as you can see quickly, the sentiment is actually going downwards for Nike in the discounts area. So this actually, again, enforces the earlier analysis that we have done. The sentiment for Nike is going down. So maybe what Adidas is doing well is in the discounts area compared to the other topics out there. So you would like to look at new releases. Again, Nike is doing fair enough. It's not that bad. It's a bit fluctuating, but still on the positive trend. Online shopping, again, sentiment is doing really well. If you'd like to look at the Adidas metrics, well, in that case, Adidas is having a downward trend again. So again, something to improve is around the online shopping area of Adidas and so on. So as you can see in the various ways of merging or consolidating different KPIs along with the sentiment as well as the topics actually enables you to find out in which are the conversational areas you are doing well in terms of brand equity. And at the same time, it gives you a visibility of how you are competition is also doing, whether they are doing better than you, whether they are doing worse than you or so on. Okay. And in that way, you actually have dedicated understanding of the insight that can actually help you taking the next call in terms of, the content that you're going to create or the campaign that you're going to launch in the coming days. Finally, what we're going to do is going a little bit in detail and much more action oriented is towards the influencer analysis. So analyzing the influence in terms of the users that you have in play. So quickly, if I would like to look at the If you see on the right hand side, we have this bubble chart that talks about the top 25 influencers by reach and sentiment. So reach is basically the amount of followers that a user has and the number of tweets that they're doing. And at the same time, we would also like to understand what's the sentiment for the tweets and compared to the reach that they have. We would like to understand whether they have a positive reach or a negative reach altogether. Okay, we would like to collaborate with those users who have a higher positive reach compared. We would like to understand the concerns around the users that have a high negative reach altogether. At the same time, we would like to understand the overall KPIs that are important for you, the application, the applause rate, the sentiment, engagement, post reach, user reach, number of followers, and number of tweets. If you select any user, you basically see the KPIs change accordingly as well. Okay. Now let's get into this bubble chart into a little detail. Okay. So this is for Adidas. So as you can see, on the x-axis, we have the average of sentiment value. And on the y-axis, we have basically the user reach that it has. So our understanding is to do more collaboration with the positive influencers that we have. So case in point would be Manchester United, even though they have very less number of tweets done, because of the high number of followers that they have, the reach that for every single tweet that they have is really, really high. So collaborating with Manchester United would be a really, really, really good opportunity. At the same time, you know, high positive sentiment towards the tweets that Real Madrid is doing. Again, the number of followers are really high. They have a huge positive sentiment towards the tweets that they are doing. So again, another effective collaborator altogether. Okay, so similar way, you can actually find out all the associated positive users that you have or the influencers that you have. At the same time, you would like to understand the users that have a negative influence. Let's say hot new hip hop, they have quite a good amount of followers, over a million followers. So you would like to understand the concerns that they have. But most importantly, for for users like Fat Kid Deals, number of tweets that they are making is really high, almost 25 tweets in the last 1 week. And because of that, even though they have a less number of followers, their reach is really, really high. And the average sentiment value of all the tweets that they are doing is almost towards the negative end. So you quickly would like to understand the concern that this particular user has, try to resolve those as quickly as possible to avoid severe damage to your brand. Now, going back, let's see the similar plot for Nike. Let's make it big. So as you can see, you have a user that is lopsiding this entire analysis altogether. Let's see who this user is. That is Nike.com. Might be the official Twitter handler of Nike. So what we're going to do is we're going to exclude this from our analysis to look at all the external influences that we have. Now, this gives us a much more clearer understanding of which influencers that we would like to do more collaboration with. So doing more collaboration with the top influencers or the positive influencers of your competition is a very good strategy to eat into their business a little bit. As you can see, Sneaker News almost has a tremendous number of tweets in a positive way for your competition, that is Nike. Even if you get a 20% of the tweets visibility, it's going to be a huge benefit for you. So this, similarly for Kicks Deals, as you can see, for your case, Kicks Deals has made very, very low number of tweets. But for Nike, for your competition, they are making huge number of tweets, 172 in the last 1 week. So based on the number of followers, even though it is low, because the number of tweets that you're doing is really high, the average reach or the user reach that it has is really, really high. So you'd like to understand what kind of engaging collaboration efforts that you can do with this particular user. At the same time, let's look at the negative impacts that the users create on Nike. And you'd like to do more and more collaboration with these guys like Foot Locker and Bleacher Report and so on. So I hope you get an understanding of having these kind of analysis done at an influencer level gives you information or insights or necessary indications towards the collaboration efforts or the campaigning efforts that you can take for your next week or the week after that or the next month. You can pinpoint the collaboration efforts in a much more focused way. You don't have to go through all the tweets that are happening, all the different areas that are going on in a manual way. You can use the solution and basically pinpoint all the information that you require. Now, going a level deeper, you can also understand the top 25 influencers for a singular topic as well. So let's say for the discounts topic, which are the top influencing users that you have? And similarly, you can do the similar analysis that we have done on the overall level for this particular topic level as well, for against your competitor also. So let's see who's talking about more and more about the discounts negativity of your competitor. Okay, so this is again going to be Stephanie Ruhl. She's made a tweet over the last week, and her followers numbers are really high. So doing collaboration with these users would be really, really great. Okay, and you can do this across all the different topics that we have, and that basically gives you the combinations of slicings that you do gives you better and better insights towards the understanding about what kind of social presence or what kinds of influencing users do you have in different areas, in different conversational spectrum. Okay, so that's our influencers analysis. And finally, we also have a page where you can basically look at the actual tweets that has been made in the actual form so that you can get another detailed understanding of the situation. So that's the overall dashboard that we have. So what we'll do next is, so this is the historical analysis that we have done, the sentiment analysis, the number of influencers that you're going to target, the overall summary, the competitor analysis across the different timeline. What are the topics that are trending right now? What are the topics that you're doing well against your competition? And finally, we have also looked at the influencer analysis across different topics, different sentiment, whether they are positive or not, what kind of reach that they have, whether the amount of reach that they are bringing in is worth the collaboration budget that you have or the campaign budget that you have or not. So all these information coming together enables you to make the right call at the right time. Finally, we also have a dashboard that basically talks about the real-time efforts or the real-time numbers that are happening. So as you can see, we have a quick look at the average sentiment of Adidas and Nike, the total number of tweets, again, for Adidas and Nike. So as you can see, Nike is still doing much, much better, almost three times the number of tweets that Adidas has. Social, in terms of social reach, again, they have a very, very high reach in terms of user base. But in average terms, they are almost in the same level. In terms of sentiment, as you can see, Adidas is doing a little better, a couple of points better than Nike. And we also have the segregation of whether they're having more and more neutral, positive or negative sentiments. So as you can see, almost equal split across the three categories. Quickly to understand the geographical split or the geographical footprint for your brand. So as you can see, India has the highest number of tweets for Adidas, almost nothing happening for Adidas in India. And you can see all the areas that Adidas is doing well, Japan, Nigeria, Malaysia, and other countries. Okay. So as you can see, in terms of the geographical spread, Adidas is not doing that well. The number of bars that you see in Nike is much higher than what you see for Adidas here. So that pretty much concludes the live aspect of KPIs that you can track and govern. Just to give you a quick understanding of how your tweets are doing in real time. Okay. Finally, what we're going to do is we're going to go back to the presentation and look at the solution aspect of things in a much more technical way. So what we have here is two solutions. One is the main one that basically has a historical process, whether it's weekly, whether it's daily, depending on your operational workflow, you can decide on that. We basically do a fetch and enriching process, basically kind of pre-processing of the activities. We do a batch topic modeling exercise, and then we do a dashboard reloading every day or every week based on your operational requirements. And we also have a real-time solution, which basically fetches and processes the data and basically gives you a live dashboard on the KPIs that you require. The metrics that we have calculated, user reach, very simple ones. Number of followers in the number of tweets that you're doing. Amplification rate is number of retweets divided by the number of followers that you have. How many likes do you get for every follower that you have? The engagements is any form of engagement, whether it's likes, retweets, or comments in a submission notation. And then you have the post reach. What's the number of views compared to the number of followers that you have? And finally, the virality. What's the amount of shares that you have corresponding to the number of views that has happened for your content? In terms of the technical architecture that you see, so we decide on the keyword parameters. We are using the Twitter API, that is the free version. We take 7 days history. We have a Python code to basically fetch that information and put it into the Maria database. And what we do next is bring that data or access that data from the Data IQ platform. This is where the majority of the processing, majority of the modeling, as you can see, reads the tweets from the MySQL database, does the processing, it executes the topic modeling exercise, the modeling and everything, and then basically writes back the topic information to the database. And finally, Power BI comes into the picture and reads that final consolidated understanding of the entire processed information and then prepares the dashboard for you. So overall, this is the solution design that we have. So quickly wrapping up what we have discussed so far and the conclusions. So as you have seen, we have the entire pipeline, the ETL pipeline that helps you to fetch and process and read and all the pre-processing activities to get all the information regarding the keywords that you'd like to get for the brand that you are serving as well for the competitors, and load it into your data warehouse on your or a database. And we also have an automated cleansing pipeline for all the tweets that you have that basically takes care of all the removal of the stop words, the emojis, the hashtags, the retweet information, and so on. And finally, you also have a dashboard which only talks about the relevant metrics that are understandable by the business users, that is the marketing team. And you also get a backend service that does this topic modeling and the sentiment modeling for the tweets that are coming into your database. So overall, as you have seen, the majority of the processing or the platform that we have used here is Data IQ, taking the benefit of the end-to-end aspect of what Data IQ provides makes your work really, really simpler. For the visualizing aspect, you can use any one that you have. It can be Oracle BI, Click, Tableau, or Power BI. In our case, we have used Power BI. And of course, we come into the picture as an implementer, as a consulting partner for you to help you guide through this entire implementation, take the right calls in terms of platforms as well as solution to get the highest amount of ROI that is possible through this entire journey. In terms of rollouts, we are looking at around 10 days of effort if there are minimal changes on the solution that you have seen. If the platform is the same, if there is not much code changes that is required, the dashboard changes are minimal, we are looking at 10 days of turnaround time. As you remember, there is an ongoing effort that is required to interpret the topics manually. So for that, if you are having a weekly process, so you would require one one day a week of effort to analyze and interpret the results that are coming out of the clusters from your topic modeling. And if you're doing in a much higher frequency, that number of effort will go up. If you need any framework changes, just some ballpark numbers, if there are code changes that we're looking at, some customization that has any code changes, we are looking at another 1 to 2 weeks of turnaround time. Dashboard changes would also have equal number of 5 to 10 days of changes. Database structures would remain more or less the same. Twitter has a very standard way of structuring their information. So not much change is going to come up from that aspect.
Thank you so much, Dhiman, for your detailed discussion on the business case. We hope that it has been useful for all the attendees. Now, as mentioned at the beginning of the presentation, it is time to open the Q&A panel. We already have questions in that myself and Dhiman will address now. If you have further, please continue putting them into the chat or in the Q&A button that you can find in the Zoom control panel. So Dhiman, I can see that we already have some questions. So would you like to take us through them?
Thanks, Jan. We did receive a couple of questions and I've already answered in the Q&A section, but people who have missed it out. So one of the questions were, how do you differentiate ClearPeaks from different platforms that are available like Sprinklr or Hootsuite? So quick clarification before moving into the answer of it. ClearPeaks is a consulting firm for data analytics required around data analytics and associated domains. We are not a product company, so there's not exactly an apple to apple comparison with firms like Sprinklr or Hootsuite, who are generalist product companies. We do, although, appreciate the platforms that Sprinklr and Hootsuite brings into the space. But what we try to differentiate our solution from what is available in these standard platforms out there in the market is our customized approach to our customers. So every customer might have their own marketing platforms that they are using. What we would like to help those customers is to find answers to specific areas that general platforms are not able to handle or are not able to answer. And at the same time, we also take our time to find out hidden insights or golden nuggets in the data that the customers capture or can capture from different means. And that is where we try to help out as much as possible. And that's our key differentiator. This also makes us very, very flexible towards, what kind of solution we can provide. So any kind of challenging situation that you might have in your social listening area, we can help you resolve those.
There is another question that's just come through, Dhiman. The solution has been built on Dataiku. Is it difficult to port it to other technologies?
Well, no, to be very honest. But we need to decide or look at what platforms are we looking at, okay? And the capabilities that it brings. And definitely based on that, there is definitely going to be some difference in the turnaround times of the implementation. What we have is all built in Dataiku. If you need to build it in another platform, we have to build it from scratch. It kind of becomes a greenfield scenario. Some additional efforts will be coming in. There was another question about, do we have the capability to sense FB, Facebook closed groups? So to answer that, Facebook closed groups are mostly private. So we generally don't recommend capturing or scraping web data from platforms which are not sanctioned by the platform to capture. Okay. And at the same time, we also respect the privacy policies of those groups in those platforms as well. So we strongly recommend against it.
There is another question also, Diman, regarding what amount of data and the data quality that is required to make the social listening case viable.
Yeah, so for the Twitter channel, the data is not going to be an issue. It's the key area that needs to be kept in mind, or the major challenging area would be around the operationalization side of things. If you're not going for a paid version of the API that Twitter provides, we need to have, we'll utilize the free version of the API and start capturing tweets from the streaming API, or we can go back max to max up to 7 days of historical data. But having that implementation set up would lay out the foundation for future analysis, so on and so forth. But having data for at least a month or more would be a good baseline to start your, let's say, the first phase of analysis.
Perfect. I hope that answered the question. If you have any other further question, please insert them in the Q&A panel. And we will wait a few seconds. Otherwise, we will proceed with the closure of the event. Good. We have a new question. How do you price your services? This is probably more from our side. Well, that depends on the model of engagement that basically we provide to our customer. As Diman has shown, there are certain possibilities for us to kind of prepackage in advance the specific use case, in which case basically we would provide, to the extent that we can, a ballpark idea for a fixed price model. Otherwise, if the service includes a broader scope in the sense of actually doing the what Diman called the data exploration for the project, then the implementation of the platform itself, the development of the use case and the deployment of it, we could possibly go towards more of a time and materials approach for a more tailored solution. So the answer is, in reality, that depends, but we are pretty much flexible with regards to the way the customer would like to tackle the project from a commercial perspective. So we can operate in both models. And I think that pretty much covers the question list. So thank you so much for attending our webinar. We hope that it's been fruitful for you. We recommend you to look into our website at the calendar of the next School Talks, and feel free to register, because the registration is already open. So wish you a great continuation of the day, and see you at the next event.